Thanks. We should take this off the mount. Hi, everyone. I'm Shadaj, and today I'm going to be talking about Scala, power, and versatility. So in this talk, I'm going to be going through a series of projects that I've been working on in the past year that show off this power and versatility of Scala. So let's get started with the first project, which is Google Code Jam. So I participate in the Google Code Jam programming contest. It's run by Google, and in it, there are a series of rounds in which you have to solve multiple algorithmic problems. So with Google Code Jam, you're allowed to pick whichever language you would like to use to solve the problems. So I chose Scala. And to make this possible, Google Code Jam lets you run your algorithm on your local machine with a downloaded data set, and then submit your source files as well as the solution to the data set to Google servers. But this process can be quite tedious. So I wrote an SBT plugin to automate submission of solutions to Google Code Jam. Okay, that should work. Okay, cool. So first, let's go through the manual submission process for Google Code Jam. First, you download your input file. This is randomly generated on Google servers, and that's what you have to run your program with. Then you modify your code to match up with the name of the input file. Since you are allowed to resubmit a solution multiple times if you don't get it right the first time, Google generates a different file name for every input that you download. So you have to always make sure that you submit the correct input file. Then you run your code with this input file name changed. You upload your output file. Now, just like your input file is going to change, your output file might change as well. So you have to make sure to upload the correct output file. Once you've done that, you have to zip up all of your source files. And finally, you upload your source files. So for every single submission you have to do in Google Code Jam, you have to go through this entire six-step process. And it would get tedious, and sometimes I would screw up the zipping, and it just got quite tedious. So I looked for ways around this. The first thing I found was a Python command line tool for Google Code Jam written by Google. But there are a few things that I didn't like about the tool. First of all, you had to store your password in a text file, and I just don't like the idea of doing that. And even with two-factor authentication, you had to bypass that by generating an application-specific password. So I looked for a way around this, and I couldn't find one, so I decided to write my own SBT plugin. So with the SBT plugin I wrote, all you do to submit is run GCJ DRS, which stands for download, run, submit, the ID of your problem, which is A, and small, which is the type of data set you want to run with. Is the microphone? Okay, yeah. So once you run this, it'll download the input for the problem, run with the solution you specified in your config in your build.sbt, and submit it to Google. So let's try it out. So I'm going to go ahead and load up the project for qualification 2015. So this is the first Google Code Jam round in which I use this plugin during the actual round. So I can go ahead and boot up SBT. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is run GCJ status. What GCJ status lets me do is check how well I did in this competition. So during the competition itself, it would show you if you got the problem correct and other things like that. But now that the competition is over, it'll show me how well I did during the competition. So I can go ahead and run GCJ status. Now, the way I bypassed the text password method used in the Python command line tool is booting up a Java X web view to take in your account credentials. And here, I actually don't even store your username or password. All you need to access the CodeJam APIs is your Google cookie. So I extract that once you sign in and use that to make all API requests. So I can go ahead and open up Authenticator, which I'll need. Okay, and now I need my two-factor authentication code. Wrong one. Okay, so I can verify. Okay, so it just did a lot of things, so I'm gonna scroll back up to see what it did. So first, this is what happened before it opened up the web view. It showed that you need to sign into your Google account, and it gave a warning not to quit the Java process, because as soon as Java X opens up the web view, an SBT process will pop up in your taskbar. So you don't want to quit that, as that will quit SBT as well. Then after you sign in, it extracts the cookie needed to use Google CodeJam APIs. It gets the middleware tokens, which are the cross-site resource forgery tokens needed to use the Google CodeJam API. It gets data that it needs to show you your status, such as contest status and problems. And then it shows me. So here I can see the first problem, I got both the small and large correct. And all other problems, I only got the small data set correct. So I wasn't able to get an algorithm fast enough to do the other solutions. So now that we've done that, let's try something a little bit different. Let's actually submit a solution. So here, the contest is in practice mode, so they let you submit test solutions to practice. So I'm going to submit problem A, which is standing ovation with a small data set. So I can go ahead and run that. It's downloading the input and ran my program. Now I say, yes, I want to submit my solution. It submits the solution, and I got it correct. So that's the flow you go through when you're using this Google CodeJam plugin. So let's go back to Keynote and see how this works. So first, the login flow. When I first ran that commit, GCJ status, it went through a series of steps to log me into the CodeJam servers so that I could access all the data I needed. So let's go through the flow of how that happens. I modeled this login steps as a series of stages and methods of how to go between stages. So here I'm not logged in. I haven't logged into Google. I haven't logged into CodeJam servers. I've done nothing. I've just booted up SBT. Now, to get to the next stage, which is signing into Google servers, I have to sign into my Google account. And it does this by opening up the Java X web view. Now that we did that, I'm in the logged in Google state. So now I've logged into Google servers. I have the cookie I need to sign in to CodeJam servers, but I haven't yet done that. So to get to the next step, I have to get my middleware tokens, which are the cross-site resource forgery tokens necessary to access the CodeJam APIs. Now we're logged into CodeJam servers, but we still can't use the download, run, and submit tasks that you would use to submit a solution, because you have to tell the CodeJam server that I'm going to be using your APIs now. And you have to do that by doing two things. One, you have to get the contest status, which tells you if the contest has yet started, if it's currently in progress, or if it's in practice mode. And the second, which is get contest problems, which allows us to get the ID of a problem given the letter ID, which is ABC, and then we can get the ID we need to use when we're talking to the CodeJam APIs. Now that we've done that, we're contest initialized. So this is the last state. Now we can run all the commands that we would like to. So here I have GCJ status, which is the command I ran at the beginning. And then I have GCJ DRS, download, run, and submit. And I've also split up this into subtasks so that you can only run a few if you would like. So this plugin is open source. It's at this URL. And next, let's go on to the next project, which is Genalgo. So a few years ago, I wrote a bioinformatics library for Scala, which allows you to represent biological sequences as Scala collections. So then you can do all of your flat mapping and any other collection methods that you would like on a biological sequence. So Janalgo started out as a JVM-only project, but over the last year, I've made it compatible with Scala.js. So now you can run bioinformatics algorithms in the browser through Janalgo. Let's try it out. So I'm going to go ahead and switch over to the browser now, because we're going to run that here. Now I'm going to go to janalgo.shadaj.me, which is the website I've set up for Janalgo documentation. So here we can see a few of the things you can do. You can create a sequence, such as DNA, RNA, or a protein with a string. You can also do it just given bases. So I've created types for each type of element you can have in a biological sequence. And here we have some transformations you can do and alignment. But what we care about is at the bottom, which is the demo that lets us align sequences from Uniprot. So what this demo is going to do is it's going to grab two similar proteins, one from a mouse, one from a human, get those from Uniprot, which is a universal protein database, and then align them to compare the areas of those sequences in the browser. So first I'm going to prefill with the protein IDs I'm going to get, and I can align. So now it's making those network requests. It got those. It aligned them in the browser. And now we can see here that we have these two sequences. So at the bottom is the comparison. So a star means that they're identical. A colon means that there is a mismatch. And a space means that there is an insertion or deletion of a amino acid in one of the two proteins. So now we can go ahead and switch over to Keynote. Okay. So when I switched over Janalgo to also work through Scala.js, I had a few issues that I had to tackle, because not everything that's in the JVM can also work exactly the same in JavaScript land. So the first of this was networking. With Janalgo running on the JVM, I use Dispatch to handle my networking, which is a really awesome library for making API requests, because it lets you handle results of HTTP requests as futures. So when I moved over to JavaScript, I needed to provide two different ways to make requests depending on which platform you're running on. So to abstract out a request maker, I created a trait here which has a method get, which takes a URL to make a request to, as well as an implicit execution context to handle your future in. And this returns a future of string, which is the text that you get after making that request. So in JavaScript, I implement this with ajax.get, which uses the Scala.js extensions ajax object to make a request and get the result as a future. On the JVM end, I have same style object with the same method, but here I implement it with dispatch. So I make the request and I handle the result as a string. Now, first I handled this HTTP request, and most of Janalgo worked at this time, but a few of the features require resources to be available, such as amino acid comparison tables, so that I can get the similarity between different amino acids. And these were originally stored in SRC main resources, so whenever I published the library, they were packaged along with the jar. But in JavaScript, there's no built-in way to handle these resources, so I had to come up with my own way to store these resources. What I ended up doing was writing a custom source generator in SBT. So what this method does is it takes a directory of sources, resources to load from, and it generates Scala objects and vals that represent different files that we can load from. So now this shared source will get compiled to both JVM and JS, and I can access resources in the same way on both platforms. So for an example, if we have a file foo.txt with two lines, first one is ABCD, and the second one is 1234, we would generate a file resources.scala with an object resources, a val foo representing that file and a list of the lines in that file. So then we can access all of the data from here on both the JVM and in JavaScript. So Jinalgo is also open source. You can find more about it at jinalgo.shadaj.me. And lastly, let's talk about the really, really fun project that I've been working on over the past summer, which combines Scala.js, Play Framework, and Akka. I call it ASH. So ASH stands for the Automated Smart Home. A few years ago, I saw the video for Brad, which is Berkeley's ridiculously automated dorm. And it was really ridiculously automated. He had a button that would put the room into instant party mode by spinning a bunch of lights around, closing the blinds, turning on a strobe light, and it would do some really cool things. So I wanted to make one of these in my room. And so ASH was born. With ASH, everything that you can automate is modeled around a series of services. So you write services that run on your server, as well as a component to that service that lets you control it from a web browser. So in this example, I have two different services. One is the Spotify service to control the Spotify music player. And the second one is a weather service, which lets me view current weather data. So one of the interesting things I did when I was rewriting ASH from scratch over the summer with Akka was creating a single pipe to communicate between all of these services. So you can have multiple services here. In this case, I have Spotify and just a weather service. But all of these services will communicate between the server and a browser with a single pipe. Here I'm using a WebSocket. So let's walk through what the control flow would be like. So let's say you clicked a button in Chrome and in the Spotify service, and let's say this is a play button, so you want to play the current song. The Spotify service, and here all services are represented as actors, will send a message to the service messenger. Service messengers act as the communication boundary between these two sides of ASH. So once this service messenger receives the message, it needs to serialize it to send over the WebSocket. So in this case, I use BooPickle, which lets me easily do cross-platform binary serialization. So here I take that object sent from the Spotify service, serialize it into binary data with Pickle, send it over the binary WebSocket, unpickle it on the other end. So this is where one of the advantages of BooPickle comes in, because it is cross-platform. So you can use the same serializers and deserializers on both sides. So here I deserialize the data with unpickle and send it to the Spotify server-side actor. Now, if we're going in the reverse direction, if Spotify wants to talk to the Spotify client on the browser, first, the server-side component will send a message to service messenger. The service messenger will pickle it on the server, and it'll get sent over the WebSocket. The service messenger in Chrome will unpickle this and send it to the Spotify actor running in Chrome. So let's do a demo. So in this demo, I'm going to be showing two services. One is Spotify from this demo, and the other one is remotely controlling a motor, which I have up here. So I'm going to be remotely rotating this motor. It's not just for a demo. There's actually a project behind this. I'm trying to automate the window blinds in my room. So we 3D printed this wheel, and the idea is we mount it on a wall, and the wheel will rotate the strings coming down from my window blinds, so we can open and close them. But for here, I just have the wheel on the motor, and let's do this. So I can go ahead and switch over to IntelliJ. I'm going to boot up this. So in this case, actually, the way that ASH works with both this JVM and JS components are it has a cross-built Scala.js project, and all of the serializers are shared files that will get both compiled to both sides. And then I have different implementations of things like service messengers to be handled differently on both ends. So here I'm going to boot up the JVM side of this project, which is AshJVM, and I'm going to boot this up. And so this is going to boot up my Play server. Okay, now I can go ahead and go to the website. And I'm going to go to /fast for the fast optimized version. So here I can go ahead and load it up. Now Ash is going to connect to Spotify. So here, okay, cool. So now I can see the current song that I was playing. And it even does some fancy things by extracting out prominent colors from the album art to set colors here. So here now I can play the music. In the sky, and I can go to the next song to play another song. And I can do some other things with this. Baby, so that's the first service. Now the second service is controlling the motor. So the setup I have here is I have a Raspberry Pi here with a motor controller on top. This is connected to my stepper motor and a power supply to run the motor. And I'm going to connect it to my laptop through this Ethernet connection. And one of the really cool things about Raspberry Pis is its LAN chip will automatically detect if you're just doing a direct connection between two laptops, so you don't have to use a special cable to do that. So I should probably plug this into here and plug this, because I'm running out of ports on my laptop. So plug this in. Now my Raspberry Pi should be booting up. I need to connect my wire for that too. So let me connect my power supply to my Raspberry Pi. So many wires. Okay, so now I'm going to be connecting my power supply to my Raspberry Pi, which is right over here. So, okay. So now the Raspberry Pi is going to boot up. And the way I've set this up is I have a jar deployed to my Raspberry Pi. When I boot that up, it's going to boot up an actor on my Raspberry Pi that's going to continuously broadcast UDP packets so that the server can identify this remote motor, because this does not have a fixed IP address. So my laptop doesn't know where this Raspberry Pi is going to end up at. So I think it booted up. So now I can go ahead and SSH into it. Hopefully this will work. Okay, so we cannot find my Raspberry Pi. Let me try searching for devices on my network here. This is connected, right? Yep. And this is connected to my Raspberry Pi. Let's try that SSH again. Come on, work. Work with me, Raspberry Pi. Okay. Yeah, sometimes the Raspberry Pi takes some time for it to boot up and connect to the network. Okay, this. Hopefully this will work. Let me just try pinging it first. Okay. Looks like we're not finding it. Let me try reconnecting this Ethernet cable. Come on, work with me. Okay, so Raspberry Pi doesn't seem to be responding to me. It is on though. How much time do I have? Okay. Okay, let me check first that my laptop has detected it. Okay, so it has found it. Okay, let's try discovering some devices on my network again. Okay, so we looks like we can't find the Raspberry Pi. So I'm just going to leave it connected for now. I'll go through how Ash works, and maybe you can try at the end to see if we can connect to the Raspberry Pi. But basically, the idea is we would have been able to connect to the Raspberry Pi with this and then toggle the motor rotation from the web interface. So in the meantime, let's go over how Ash works. So Ash is built upon services. Services have two components, a JavaScript end and a JVM end, and they have a shared component, which is the serializers. So on the JavaScript end, you have an actor, which handles taking an input from the browser. You have a voice component, so you can voice control. So I can show that. So here, if I reload, OK, Ash. My laptop doesn't seem to be working either. Let's try that again. OK, Ash. Spot, play next spot. Yeah. OK, Ash. Play next song.
Now playing Animals by Maroon 5.
So now I'm able to voice control Spotify. It even responds with some voice cues that what song is playing now. So now I can control it again. I think that's not a command, so let's go into the code and see what the command is. So I'm going to actually go into the code for the Spotify service here. So all services in Ash are implemented as actors. So here I actually have an actor which represents the Spotify running in my browser. So let's go to where I'm registering. So this should work. Pause the song. So let's try this. Okay, Ash doesn't seem to be wanting to work with me today. But yeah, when it's quiet enough, Chrome will tell Ash that now the voice recognition is complete and it usually finishes off. So that's Ash. Now we still have a few more things in Ash. One of the interesting things about Ash is that it's built for modularity. So you can use the Ash core and add services to it. So the way Ash detects services is you have to put a package identifier, which in the case of Spotify is me.shadaj.ash.spotify. And underneath this package, you'll have serializers as well as a service actor. And in the case of the JavaScript end, since we can't use reflection with Scala.js, I have you export it so that I can find it using the global JavaScript namespace. So service detection on the JVM, this is just reflection. I find the package, and I find the serializer's object there, as well as the service actor, and I boot up that actor. So that's what I'm doing here. And in the JavaScript end, I have my service store, which looks through all the services. So here I'm actually using the same resource Scala object generation from Janalgo. And here I just use Scala.js dynamic to go ahead and get all of those objects that I need to use. Now, with serializers, I want all serializers to automatically be exported. So in the trait serializers, I use the annotation JS export descendant object, which basically makes anything that extends a serializer be automatically exported. So here, I require you to define a pickler of anyref and an unpickler of anyref. And this is usually built with a composite pickler from BooPickle, which lets you specify multiple types that you can handle in this pickling. Now, one of the things that I had to do when I was writing the portion of Ash for JavaScript was, how do you write an actor in Scala.js? Because Akka is not built for Scala.js, so that I could get that feel of writing an actor and having those messages sent, I wrote Appa, which is the fake Akka for Scala.js. So this is majority of Appa. Here I'm implementing an actor. I just have fake implementations of everything, but it's functional. So I don't do any fancy web worker or asynchronous calls or anything, but you can still get the feel and have those state machines that you would expect from Akka. So here I have implementations of everything, and then you have an actor ref. And here I'm not doing anything fancy with actor paths. An actor ref just stores a reference to the actor it's referencing, and it has a method send, which takes a message, as well as an implicit sender, so that you know who the sender was if you want to send a message back. So these two libraries are both open source. Not as of now. I'll open source them right after I finish this talk, because I forgot to do that. And so maybe now we can try and see if my Raspberry Pi woke up. Come on. Ah, OK, so it looks like it's not going to work with me today. But when it does work, it works really nicely. It starts broadcasting out UDP packets. My server parses out those packets and figures out the IP address of the actor here. Then it connects to that actor. A remote link is established. We also set things like death watches to automatically reconnect to the actor if either end drops out. And with that, you're able to even voice control the motor. So that's another voice control I wrote. So that's it for all of the projects I'm going to be showing today. So we've seen a lot of different projects that you can do with Scala today. We saw a SBT plugin for communicating with Google CodeJam servers and submitting solutions. We were able to run bioinformatics algorithms in the browser, and we were even able to see a primitive home automation system. So here are a few links so if you want to follow the stuff I'm working on. I put all my code on GitHub. I have a YouTube channel where I publish videos about Scala programming, and I also have a website. And I'm ready to answer any questions if you have them. Okay, yeah. So he asked if we're doing remoting between the laptop and the Raspberry Pi. So we actually, yeah, I'm doing that. We use TCP with Akka's TCP remoting support. So here we boot up an actor here. This broadcasts out its own path to the actor. This laptop finds that path, connects to that actor, and the link is established. Yeah, here, UDP multicast. Yeah, so I listen to the server whenever I find a packet that is for that service, because you might have multiple Raspberry Pis connected to the same network. So I look for one that's for that service and connect to that actor. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.